So I'm very happy, as you can see from this picture, being here. It's warmer. Actually, Oxford is an interesting place. I learned a lot of things, although I didn't get my degree there. I've been there now for 6 years. And I learned a very important truth. Really smart people make amazingly stupid decisions consistently. That's not to say that we're not making smart decisions. After all, somehow we need to get the moniker smart people. But in general, just having a high intelligence, having a good education, is generally not enough to make your decision-making good. So I'm going to here do a much more theoretical and meta talk than all the other talks at this conference. So I hope you can bear with me with that. So the main idea is that I'm just going to bring out a few design patterns, ideas, concepts, and tricks that I learned from our work at the Future Humanity Institute. We're trying to think about the long-term, big-picture future of our species and the possible successor species. And one of the most interesting issues here is, of course, that we don't have the information. We're really uncertain about the future. Which is in itself interesting, because the reason we're standing around here having conferences and having PowerPoints and cryonics is, of course, that we've got great brains and we're very good at predicting the future. We're extremely good at coming up with little scenarios. What happens if I go out of that door? What happens if I mix these different cryoprotectants together? What happens if I invest in that fund? And in many cases, it actually works. It generally works best on our personal level. Our animal brains are very well adapted to solving the animal kind of problems, like getting around in the environment and finding food. Our more human levels of mind are better at handling a lot of human interactions. However, as we get further away from our comfort zone, when we get out there in the world of futures, advanced technological systems, or concepts that didn't exist just a few years ago, we run into real problems. Unfortunately, that's of course where decision making is important. So, what can we do about it? Well, we can aim for rationality. And philosophers have always loved this idea. Of course, when you start picking at it, it becomes a bit unclear what it means. A friend of mine usually points out that, Anders, when you call somebody or something rational, that just means that they agree with you. I usually respond with saying, yes, of course, that is the definition of rationality. But he doesn't let me get away with that. The actual thing is, of course, we want certain things, and we should probably use the best means to get to these ends. This is called instrumental rationality, and one of the few things about practical reason that philosophers generally agree on, yeah, we need that. And then, of course, there are more interesting things for the philosopher debate. However, if you're an AI programmer instead and try to put that into your device, you get an awful headache. It's very hard. It actually turns out that the problems around creating rational agents, that is one of the most fertile areas of research right now in the intersection between economics, game theory, artificial intelligence, and philosophy. It turns out that building a good decision theory is amazingly hard. We have the economist coming up with this beautiful idea of the rational agents who try to maximize the expected utility. For every state of the universe, they have a utility function that evaluates how good it is, and then you just do the action that produces, on average, the best utility. The little downside, as anybody can figure out, is that it's very hard to build such a system that can actually look at the entire state of the universe and accurately predict what's going to happen. You can say, oh yeah, we're going to approximate it. But it turns out that even those approximations are quite non-trivial. That's one reason why we're not having any robot butlers around for the moment. Another reason is, of course, that we're quite bad at figuring out what we want. You need to know what you want in order to try to get it rationally. And in many ways, humans are completely biased. We don't have a utility function. It doesn't look like there's anything like that in our brains. People have certainly been looking. There are certainly interesting other structures in our decision-making system that make a lot of sense from a computational standpoint, but we probably evolved at most to approximate this. And that is, of course, the interesting situation that we produce a lot of behaviors that at least wouldn't be accurate according to an economics textbook. Quite often we would say, that's because economists are very weird and biased people after reading too much economics textbooks. Behavioral economy have been trying to kind of deal with the quirks of how actual humans make actual decisions. And in many cases, the problem is actually not too bad. Yeah, it might be against the textbook, but it actually makes sense. If I give away some money, it might be because I like somebody or because I want to send a signal. I have all sorts of reasons, some of which ones are very murky and complicated. The real problem is, of course, when we actually become deliberately stupid. Of course, most of the time we pretend that we're not deliberately stupid. So this is one of our favorite topics in the office, and this is just a short list of cognitive biases. We once had the full Wikipedia page listing them all printed out, hanging from ceiling to floor. Every time we passed by it waved as a kind of warning, don't do any of this. Yeah, right. We have one paper where we kind of dealt a little blow against status quo bias. It's just a few hundred remaining. Some of these ones are in a kind of classic, the gambler's fallacy. You tend to see your patterns, and so if you got heads three times in a row, of course it's going to be a heads next time. Or maybe you have the opposite version of it. Oh yes, it has to become tails. We have a lot of interesting ones like hyperbolic discounting, that we tend to prefer a reward that is coming close in time rather than far into the future. And this shows that many of these biases are important for cryonics. Given hyperbolic discounting, of course, we will tend to think that, I could pay this to Alcor, or I could buy ice cream. Well, ice cream it is. The problem is, of course, that a lot of these biases are very much built into it, because biology is trying to solve a rather tricky problem. So we have an approximation of rationality that works quite well. We shouldn't expect it to be perfect. Philosophers have tended to assume we were perfectly rational, and that means that a lot of their arguments don't really make much sense in practical life. But they have gotten much more sensible in recent years and actually started doing brain scans and actually checking. How do people, for example, make moral decision making? Oh dear, that was scary, at least for the ethicists. The interesting thing about these biases is that some of them we can overcome. Quite a lot of them, just by being aware of it, you can kind of wrest the control over. And it's even better if your neighbor points out gleefully, you're suffering from a selection bias there. The problem is, of course, that you need to be able to take that, and then you give back, but you're overconfident, and so on. The problem is some biases don't even go away when you get educated about them. I'm deeply scared of anchoring. If I were to state the number 743, and then ask you about a price for, let's say, one of the artworks out there, it's very likely that your estimated price would now gravitate a little bit towards the number 743. Although that had nothing to do with any prices or anything. And this is a bias that doesn't disappear even if you're smarter or have a higher education or I even tell you about bias. That's profoundly frightening when you start thinking about it. Okay, but what else can we do? Well, we have the uncertainty. The biases are systematically forcing us in some direction. Uncertainty is a bit like the winds that are blowing us to and fro. And we're trying to resist them, but quite often we don't know how to predict that darn wind, so we're leaning in the direction the wind is blowing and falling over. So typically we can divide this in a lot of ways, and this is fun. So you people have done a lot of different setups. This is just one possible. Quite often we're uncertain about the value or amount of something. What's the probability that something is going to happen? So in our mental model of cryonics, for example, we have a probability of a suspension team coming to one's home. Now we got information during the previous talks about that. We have updated this, but it's still a somewhat uncertain number, of course, because it depends on a lot of factors. I don't fully expect an Alcor team to show up unannounced in my Oxford home, for example. Then we have a model uncertainty. We have a model of the world, but that might be wrong. And this is much trickier, because it doesn't matter if I got all the numbers right, if I calculate the wrong thing. And then there is the really tough forms, sometimes called Knightian uncertainty. This is ignorance. This is that it's not just that my model is wrong. I don't know really important things about it, and I won't ever be able to find out all the relevant things. This is where the black swans live. This is the kind of nasty surprises that really are outside our reasoning. And finally, there is a kind that quite often people don't notice, but I think it's important. We actually don't know what's good. We quite often have strong opinions, and maybe even good ideas about it, but we're not certain. So this is both a question that we don't know quite what is good for us, but also maybe not even which moral system is true. This is an interesting problem. Actually, I just noticed somebody trying to make the kind of copy of a Hilbert program of profound problems for the next century in mathematics. Now people are trying to do the same with ethics. And one of the profound ethics problems is, how could we actually do proper thinking when we're uncertain about our morality? This is something that keeps a lot of my colleagues very busy. But from a rationality standpoint, of course, this is interesting. We better figure out what we actually want in order to get it. So here is one example of how uncertainty and ignorance can really mess up one's day. So here is a typical urn, and anybody who studied statistics know what's going to happen. I put in 10 black balls, 10 white balls, and then I ask you, what's the probability of drawing a black ball from the urn? And of course, everybody says 50% and goes back to sleep. Well, now let's spice it up. Let's add a demon. The demon saunters over and does something to the urn. What's the probability now? And now, very tricky things might have happened. Yeah, he might have removed a black ball, or added one, or added a red ball, or why not a frog? So this is where traditional probability theory actually completely breaks down. Probability theory is based quite often on what is called the Kolmogorov axioms. Essentially, one of them says, well, there is an outcome space, the realm of what's possible, and that's not supposed to change. Now we just change it by having this demon doing an uncertain chain. There are ways around it, but they're all very tricky. The most amazing thing, however, that you should remember in the rest of the talk is, of course, that normally we end up with these frogs all the time. We're little demons all out in the world, confusing our world, surprising us, and we actually make do. So there are obvious ways that are somewhat functional. Another interesting thing is, of course, that sometimes things happen that shouldn't happen at all. If you do a Google search for I'm 100% certain or it will never happen that, you're going to find a lot of very lousy predictions. Most of them are, of course, kind of statements. You show your confidence. You show that you're really believing this. But when you go through it from a strictly rational standpoint, they're kind of absurd. If you have zero in belief in something, that means that no amount of evidence will ever convince you about it, because all alternative explanations would be better. So the 100% confident atheist wouldn't believe it when God shows up with all his angels and realms of empirically verifiable truth on his doorstep. No, because it would be much more likely, of course, that any other explanation would work. In that case, I think we could say, yeah, maybe it could be a hallucination, etc., etc. And you could still supply an infinite amount of evidence against that. And this guy would irrationally still persist. So any rational person must always say that all the probabilities I'm dealing with are between somewhere above zero and below 100%. This is a bit tricky, because there are a lot of things we are really certain about. It's stupid to not believe in gravity. And we need to actually be able to kind of keep our minds open without brains falling out. So you can actually do this in a boring statistical mode too. You can actually calculate, okay, if I've not seen any evidence in a number of trials, what's the probability, given that it could be anything from the start, that I'm going to see something happening? And at the blue line at the bottom there, that's what happened after one trial. Well, yeah, I didn't see anything happen. Well, maybe it's more likely that it's not going to happen than it is. And as you add on, you get more and more confident. The interesting thing is this applies to a lot of technologies that we care about. After all, so far we have not seen any cryonic revival. Does that mean it cannot possibly ever happen? No, it's just that the probability is slightly lower. When a lot of my friends are working on artificial intelligence, so far we have been consistently failing at human-level artificial intelligence for 60 years. Is that evidence that it's impossible? No, probably that it's either very hard or that we're using the wrong strategy. One can have quite fun with calculating these probabilities, but the important part is, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. it's possible to reason even when you have not gotten any new information. And this is typically where engineers get rather shocked that philosophers can say so horrible things. But it's useful, because we need to reason when we are uncertain. And quite often, even our normal, certain scientific arguments turn out to be wrong. The probability of being wrong in a scientific paper is about at least 1%, and that's kind of calculating kindly. I'm ignoring fraud here, we're just looking at papers with statistical mistakes and similar things. So when you think about that, a paper showing that a physics experiment cannot destroy the world, well, we start out being uncertain whether it's dangerous, paper comes out, and it argues that, it's just one chance in a million that it's unsafe. But what actually happens is, of course, there is a certain chance that the paper is wrong. Now, the cool thing is that we can find a way around it. Write another paper, use another method, and you can actually reduce the gray area, the real uncertainty. So my second big lesson is, a lot of this uncertainty can be reduced by using several different methods. This is why it's so important to have an interdisciplinary team that can work and talk together, but also use completely different methods of approaching the problem. Quite often, this is a very reliable way of getting reliable arguments. And we should really wish that the risk assessment and other analyses were to apply this more consistently. This is why literature reviewers in scientific journals are supposed to separately evaluate papers. And this also shows why it's rather hard to do this independent, because typical reviewers tend to have similar views. But when it works amazingly well. And we should refine this. Okay, what else can we do? Well, there is a lot of things we don't know, and I don't have the time to even get into all these wonderful things, from the undecidable statements that are logically hard to deal with, over to uncomputable statements, over to stuff that's just too large to fit into human minds, over to the cozy areas of quantum mechanics and chaos. There is quite a lot of it. But we are also rationally ignorant about a lot of it, because it costs effort, money, time, attention to actually figure certain things out. And that's all right. It's actually part of rational thinking not to care about certain things, as long as you have a good reason to think that that information would be too costly for me to acquire. Again, it's a bit paradoxical, but sometimes it's a good idea to not know things. And of course, some things might be dangerous to know too. So, getting to the future of technology. Generally, of course, everything is getting better according to an exponential curve, and soon our computers are going to be faster than the universe, at least according to how certain journalists mangle the statements of scientists. And generally, there are different ways of approaching these questions about what technology we're going to get. One approach, Eric Drexler, who's currently working in Oxford, has been pioneering a lot, is looking at what the realm of possibility. We are bound by the physical laws, so we have some firm boundaries out there, far away from what we can do. And then we have the stuff we can do, and then we can analyze a lot of interesting things in between. And using that exploratory engineering, we can learn a bit more about future technologies. I don't have the time to do anything, and I'm not going to try to steal his talk here. So I'm just going to point out that whenever you can find a good constraint, a really solid physical law limiting or allowing you to do something, it's good. However, claims you can't possibly do that because of this physical law usually don't work out historically. Why? Well, because most good engineering is about finding a devious way around physical laws. Another interesting thing that people are going to kind of show, especially at conferences like this, we all love seeing these progress curves showing that stuff getting better and better, cheaper and faster, and at some exponential rate. But I want to point attention to this interesting knee. At that point, suddenly progress speeded up quite a lot. And this is fairly common. This is another favorite graph. So this is the US GDP per capita, and this is the energy use per capita. And there is a rather steep, very straight line from the Second World War upwards until 1972. Up until that point, any economist would have said, it's obvious that any civilization that wants to have a higher standard of living must use much more energy. And then the oil crisis came, and suddenly it turned out that law was replaced by a roughly horizontal behavior. Again, this shows that understanding of the background in a system can be very important. And that systems that have these trends can change surprisingly fast. Sometimes that's for the good. So this might be hard to see, but this is computational power per dollar per second. And up here we have a traditional Moore's law, and this was the state the century before. Well, there was essentially no progress. If Moore had been around in the 19th century, he would say, yes, my law is that nothing is happening. And he would have been completely right to a high precision until about 1940, when suddenly everything went exponential. The scary part is, of course, that that might mean that it stops being exponential equally quickly. And that is real uncertainty. Just plotting something along a trend line, well, that's a best guess, but we should be aware and prepared for uncertainty. And sometimes that can be rather bad. After all, if you just use trend lines, we should be not just at Alpha Centauri by now, but much further away. And of course, you can interpret the same data in very different ways. And so actually, Kurzweil had been in an interesting debate with another expert. They've been using exactly the same data. And MODIS has been arguing that this data shows that, yes, technology is slowing down. And Kurzweil is using the same data to show that it's accelerating. Yeah. And Le Poir done a marvelous job at showing that, well, it seems like the high point of physics was about around Einstein and Planck, and since then we've been slowing down. So this shows that, yeah, data is good, but it's hard to interpret in a reliable way. It's still fun, of course, to run jackknifing statistics to figure out what's happening in computers in the future. And we can use this to understand a little bit about the problem of prediction. So this would be something like Moore's law, typical technology advancing small steps, engineers solving problems, maybe a lot of people working together, but you have a lot of small problems and you get a relatively smooth curve. And other technologies are much more like this one. You get sudden jumps. And when you start comparing technologies, you find that this is more typical for those that are connected to ideas, insights. In order to do something better, you actually need to do it differently rather than slightly tweak it. The problem is, of course, all technologies worth caring about are of this kind. So when you compare them, doing predictions about the smooth ones, where there is a lot of engineering grind, not much problem, while the insight-driven ones are all over the place. The variance goes up amazingly much by time. Now, thinking of cryonics, of course, this is a bit worrying because when we're thinking about breakthroughs, we're firmly setting our aims at something like that, which means that we're going to have a very high uncertainty about when anything is going to be achieved. And, well, I don't have time for that. And we can do a lot of fun modeling, which I'm also having very little time for. But here is a cute example I was playing around with. So if imagine an asteroid going to hit us in 100 years. The amount of energy it takes to push it out of the way with enough margin, of course, goes up with the inverse of the time remaining. But our technology is getting better. So when should we be acting? Well, it turns out that we should probably be acting in about 70 years or so. Because by that point, we have so much energy thanks to our technology that is much better. So we can just lace around, which is good, unless we're wrong about our measurement of technology. At which point we suddenly see the interesting thing that actually we should probably do it much earlier. And then we add in, and how long does it take before Congress grants the money for this project? We should probably do it directly. So this is the important thing. That uncertainty tells us we ought to speed things up a lot. The more uncertain we have in a system, we might actually want to put a lot more resources into going ahead faster. So, cryonics. Cryonics is fun from an uncertainty perspective because it has so much of it. And some of it is kind of vanilla. My future economic situation at reanimation. Oh, yes, that's something we can ask insurance people and doctors about. The storage situation and the suspension, that's a tricky one. But we have some data, I would assume, at Alcor. Then you have the fun ones about technology advance, how much we can trust that. Not to mention the reanimation. The most important thing for this from a PR perspective is that people hate uncertainty. So one of the main reasons people are afraid of cryonics, not the only one by any means, but an important one, is that it actually forces you to confront these uncertainties. And most people hate that, which is sensible. So in order to play around with this, I did my own little mathematical model here. It's rather crude, so I'm happy to run out of time so I don't have to exhibit all the problems with it. But it's kind of a little demonstration how you can use modeling together with a bit of philosophy to think about what we need to care about. So basically you have fictional people coming in here at a certain age, and then they age, and according to a mortality table, eventually they start falling down dead. They might also have be luck. In some of the runs, life extension comes into play. So I have a model when that is invented and how strong it is, and that slows down aging. I kind of borrowed some ideas from a paper in co-authored by Aubrey. So that slows things down. Then, of course, they might be unlucky and not have a contract, or they are suspended, which might turn out that, then there is staying there frozen. But in the meantime, the world might end. Existential risk is something we actually worry about quite a lot at our institute. We've been calculating, estimating that, and it's much higher than most people think, especially if you're lying around frozen for a very long time. Those small probabilities do add up. However, it might also turn out, of course, that cryonics doesn't work. There is a certain probability for that. And then, of course, they might be lucky. There might be either a singularity that solves all the problems, or cryonics actually, and it turns out to be working in a more traditional form, so you get back. So if you run this without any cryonics, you essentially get this distribution of the running 10,000 people. So, they're deanimated, except for those who ended up when the giant meteor or nanomachine, the apocalypse, or something else happened to Earth. One interesting thing is actually that this chunk is much bigger than most people expect, because most of the time the world doesn't end. The problem is, of course, when it does end, all the statisticians are also going to go with it. There is a tiny number of people that actually survive thanks to life extension, but generally, cryonics changed the picture quite a lot. Still, a lot of these people in this model end up deanimated, and still, existential risk is a problem. And yes, a lot of them didn't have a suspension arrangement done properly. But there is a quite nice chunk up here that actually do survive. It's not a small chunk, it's not still a small sliver. And of course, if you're a singularitarian, you might also add a certain probability of singularity to this, and you get even more. There are a few interesting things that I'm going to conclude with my last minute or so. So generally, of course, not getting suspended is about as dangerous to you as the end of the world. It's an interesting way of putting it, but I think it's quite true. And also, if you care about life extension and staying alive, you should actually care about these big global threats much more. And also, it seems that the biggest risk that is very easy to deal with is, your probability of actually having a cryonics contract and getting a suspension. So make sure you sign up and do that properly. One interesting thing is that the risk from cryonics organizations' failures is actually surprisingly small in this model. And then there are interesting problems that the singularity might or might not make things better or worse. But what kind of confused me or surprised me was actually the importance of existential risk. In general, this is an understudied problem, and people ought to care a lot more about it. Since we want to live a lot longer, we should care even more about it. The coolest thing is that the ordering of these events actually matters. Some of them are shielding each other. And sometimes it might be worth going more slowly. If you're a normal life extensionist or singularitarian, that sounds horrible. However, cryonics actually affords us some time to wait. And generally, people have not been studying questions of human extinction very much. Most academic papers are about much more cool things like dung beetles. I like dung beetles myself, so nothing foul on them. But generally, it seems like I've been trying to give you a few tools here, a few mental tricks or weird habits that can help here. So the most important one is figure out what you actually want and whether you're going in the direction of what you want. If you have done a mistake there, then nothing else matters. Also, sometimes it matters not to figure out stuff. Aim for what you actually can learn that's useful. We're really overconfident about a lot of things, so actually recognizing that it's all right not to know stuff is good. However, people hate hearing that. So credibility, you need to look confident, but that's false. Also, understanding complex systems, I didn't have the time to get into it, only works when we're neatly isolated. So this is why a lot of science works very well in the lab and bad out in the field. So the trick is to try to construct robust models, whether that is mathematical model of cryonics or the actual practice of cryonics or how you actually run your own lives. Thank you.